I understand. And lastly, Imam Kareem, both my parents are deceased, so alhamdulillah, I try to go every Friday to visit their qabr because it's a sunnah. I give the salam that Rasulullah used to give to the deceased. Now, I hear a lot of people around me reading Quran and reading Yasin. I don't do that. I just make dua, I come home. Am I doing something wrong?
Okay, we have to go through a couple of things here, Sister Aisha. Thing number one is you visiting the graveyard every day. Every Friday you mentioned.
No, just Friday. Just Friday.
I would not encourage you to do this at all. First of all, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, and you brought up a very, very good issue actually, and I think we should talk about it. Nabi sallallahu, let me just begin from here. When we die, we go to a different world, correct? The world of the unseen. Now, the living feel, for the deceased, like you feel for your father and you feel for your mother, and you want to benefit them. You really want to benefit them, true? That's your intention. Now, if I tell you something, you're going to do something. Now, who's going to take that deed or the benefit of that deed to them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you must follow what Allah commanded you to do. Okay? Here is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned regarding benefiting the deceased. Hadith, very known hadith in the Sunnah, hadith Abi Hurairah radiyallahu an fi al-Bukhari wa Muslim, إذا مات ابن آدم وفي رواية الإنسان, when the son of Adam dies, انقطع عمله إلا من ثلاث. He does not receive any more deeds except from three sources. Number one, ولد صالح يدعو له, which is you, alhamdulillah. Walad here means offspring for the Arabic speaking people, brothers and sisters, the Arabic speaking people. Walad does not mean just boy, okay? Walad is offspring. That could be a girl, that could be a boy, that could be grandchildren too. So waladun salihun yad'ula. So, but here is a restriction that you must be righteous and pious in order for your dua to be accepted. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam restricted the dua to be from a righteous offspring. This is number one. Now the question is, do you have to go to the graveyard in order to make dua? You do not have to. You can actually make dua at home. You can make dua in your sujood. You can make dua at night for them. Allah knows best who are your parents. Allah knows best that you're making dua for those people, even without even mentioning and uttering their names. Sometimes I see some brothers in janazah prayers naming the person. You don't have to name. Allah knows who is the dead person. Allah knows, if your dua is going to go to them, even without you knowing them to begin with. Number one, the dua. Number two, the sadaqah al-jariyah. Sadaqah al-jariyah is so I just wanted you to stay away from visiting the graveyard every Friday, because this is too much. And again, let me just shed more light on the issue of visiting the graveyards. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sister Aisha, when he spoke about allowing us to visit the graveyards, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wal hadith fi sunan, Sunan ibn Majah and others, كُنْتُ قَدْ نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ أَلَا فَزُورُوهَا. I have banned you earlier to visit the graveyards, I want you to visit it now. And now he mentioned al-illah. Al-illah, al-hukm, هذا حكم, this is a ruling that is combined with a reason for it. ما هي العلة? What is the reason? فإنها تذكركم بالآخرة. وفي رواية فإنها تذكركم بالموت. Because if you visit the graveyards, it will remind you the living of death. I'm sorry. It will remind you of the hereafter. So you actually go to the graveyard for you, not for the deceased. You see, that's the concept that we got to change in our minds. Because there is an issue there that people believe that the deceased know who is the visitor. We have no evidence for this. The only time, Sister Aisha, and I'm glad you opened this subject up because it's a very sensitive subject in the Ummah, and somebody got to speak about it. You see, the only time that we know that the deceased is aware of a living standing by his graveyard is after the burial. Huh? حديث فيمس حديث عند سنة حديث البراء ابن عازب رضي الله عنهما، والحديث في مستدرك الإمام أبو عبد الله النيسابوري الإمام الحاكم، وقال على شرط مسلم. This hadith meets the requirement of الإمام مسلم. A beautiful hadith that talks about the soul coming out of the body and journey of the soul. And وله شاهد. This hadith also has a witness في صحيح مسلم حديث عبد الله ابن عمرو بن العاص. حديث عمرو بن العاص when عمرو بن العاص was dying he left his wasiyah for his son Abdullah and he said to him and I want you to stay after you bury me as my family member for a period of time because I will feel your company. I will feel your company. Now this is the only time that we know in our sunnah that the deceased, someone in the graveyard recognizes and knows there is a living standing by the graveyard. Now we cannot use analogy to extend the text to be permanent. No. You see, this is something that a qaida or a rule, once we deal with unseen, you cannot stretch the text more than it takes, okay? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned this in the occasion of burial. That means there is no evidence whatsoever that the deceased feel the company or the presence of the living if they go and visit the graveyard. So here is the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam is telling us we need to go to visit the graveyards because it will remind us the living with al-akhirah. It will remind us with death. So this should be the only reason, motive for you to go to the graveyards. Not any other motive. If you want to make dua for the deceased, for your family, for your father and mother at home, in your tahajjud, make dua for them. In your sujood, make dua for them. All right? So these are some of, yeah, alhamdulillah. So these are, once it comes to the offspring. Now we have more than, we mentioned sadaqah jariyah, that you can give sadaqah on their behalf. You can also, alhamdulillah, or you can spread knowledge for them, like, you know, like spreading the knowledge, like alhamdulillah.
I had a very big water fountain, we call it the cheshmen.
Alhamdulillah. May Allah accept from you. Also knowledge, like a book, like if you circulate a CD or a YouTube or something that benefit people, this is all for them, inshallah. Also, thabat. Also, it was authentically narrated as well, Sister Aisha, that you could do Hajj and Umrah for them. Provided with one restriction here, that you have done it, yeah, you have finished yours. Making up mandatory fast that they could not make during their lives. There is a hadith about it. Or nadr, or siyamun nadr, but voluntary no, or a vowing, or voluntary no. Sister, anything else is a bid'ah. Recitation Quran, Khatm al-Quran, and all this stuff, and every culture has developed its own. I come from Egypt myself. They convene every 40 days, every 1 year. The brothers in Africa developed their own theory. The brothers in Pakistan developed something called Khatm al-Quran, where they bring small pieces of the Quran. كل هذا, all of this is a bid'ah. Bid'ah. Now once we say this, the brothers get upset at you and they say, يا شيخ بدعه ازاي, we're reciting the Quran. يا أخي, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, يا إخوة, والله I love you for the sake of Allah. والله I'm not being mean. I love you for the sake of Allah. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. الحديث في صحيح البخاري ومسلم من حديث عائشة رضي الله عنها, whoever introduces a practice to this deen, it is rejected. Look at the wording of الإمام مسلم of this hadith. من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Whoever does an act that I did not sanction, that I did not prescribe for you, it's rejected. Bring me one single evidence from the sunnah of the Prophet. That, يعني, okay, do you love the Prophet more than Abu Bakr? Do you love your parents more than Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman loved the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Have you ever heard Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman and Ali and the others sitting and doing khatma for Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Yeah, where? يعني, نحن نأخذ ديننا من الكتب. We take our religion from the book. And Sister Aisha, because you touched a very sensitive area, and I'm glad somebody brought brought this up. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya ikhwa, before his death. And he, in a way, he was explaining this. He was explaining the verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah, one of the last verses that was revealed on the day of Arafat. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Today I have completed the deen for you, perfected it for you, and Islam is your religion. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول ما تركت شيئا. I have not left one thing. يقربكم إلى الله. That will bring you closer to Allah. And distance you from the hellfire, but I commanded you to do. And I have not left one thing that will bring you far away, distance you from Allah, and bring you closer to the hellfire, but I disallowed you, I banned you from doing it. So the deen is complete. Now, if I come now, 1400 plus years after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I introduce a practice in this religion, then I'm saying, look at the statement, whatever the Prophet said was not correct. The Prophet forgot to tell us about this, and I came up with it. لا, this is a ولذلك والله يا أختي الإمام يا أخت عائشة الإمام مالك بن أنس رحمه الله إمام دار الهجرة يقول من أحدث في الدين من ابتدع في الدين whoever introduces a practice to the religion and he sees it a good practice فقد زعم أن محمدا قد خان الرسالة. He is claiming that Muhammad betrayed his message. Can you imagine the statement? استغفر الله استشهد أن لا إله وسوء الظن بالنبي كفر. And you doubting. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم tells you I completed the deen for you. Now you're introducing something new to the deen. That means you're saying to the Prophet, oh Messenger of Allah, you forgot this one. So I'm helping you out. Oh Messenger of Allah, maybe you did not deliver this one. So I'm helping you out. لا ينفع. We have النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says تركت فيكم ما إن تمسكتم به لن تضلوا بعدي أبدا كتاب الله وسنتي. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said I have left amongst you what if you follow you will never go astray, the book of Allah and my sunnah. And look at خطبة الحاجة sister عائشة. I'm sorry, you just opened up a wound. You opened up a wound in my heart, a wound. Look at this at خطبة الحاجة before he even delivers his speech. وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers, you know the translation of this. Any newly invented manner, practice of this deen is called bid'ah, and it will lead to the hellfire. And I close with this because the phone is ringing off the hook, and I want to take the rest of the other calls. Sister Aisha, is in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kama fi sunan al-Tirmidhi. Listen to this. Hadith al-Irbad ibn Sariya radiallahu anhu, wahuwa min ahl al-Suffa. And subhanallah, this companion was so soft-hearted that when, you know, he could not find anything, any means to go with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go to the battle of Tabuk, he started crying and weeping. And Allah revealed Quran on him. وَلَا عَلَى الَّذِينَ إِذَا مَا أَتَوْكَ لِتَحْمِلَهُمْ قُلْتَ لَا أَجِدُ مَا أَحْمِلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ تَوَلَّوا وَأَعْيُنُهُمْ تَفِيضُ مِنَ الدَّمْعِ حَزَنًا أَلَّا يَجِدُوا مَا يُنْفِقُونَ. He said, خطبنا أو وعظنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم موعظة. This companion said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم one day delivered a موعظة to us, admonition to us. فرقت منها القلوب. رقت منها القلوب. Our hearts became so softened. وزرفت منها العيون. And we started tearing and crying. We felt that الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم is giving us his final نصيحة. قلنا يا رسول الله, we said, oh messenger of Allah, لعلها موعظة مودع. We just feel from the way that you're speaking, oh messenger of Allah, that this may be the last time you're gonna speak to us. Give us نصيحة, final نصيحة يا رسول الله. He said this, if you live after me, you will find a lot of different things, a lot of different practices, a lot of bid'ahs basically. فعليكم بسنتي, follow my way. وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي and the rightly guided خليفه after me. Look at this sister Aisha, he did like this. عضوا عليها بالنواجذ. Do like this. Do like this. Don't let go. Don't let go. Because so follow the sunnah and may Allah reward you, ya Rab, and may Allah have mercy on your family.
It's all our cultures, Imam Karim. You know, you grow up and everyone does the 3, the 7, the 40, and I say no, this is not in the sunnah. So alhamdulillah for answering I planted the trees on my parents' grave. Is it okay to just
لا, no, 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 no. هذا من خصوصيات النبي. This is something that is special for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. We know the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did it. But the scholars of hadith, they say this is something that is specially for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Not for us.
Don't do that.
No, don't do this. A graveyard is a graveyard.
Leave the grass.
Yeah.
Leave the grass.
Make dua. Yeah. Make dua for them. That's what you need to do. Inshallah. جزاك الله خيرا. جزاك الله خيرا. And make dua for me, inshallah. جزاك الله خير سيستر عائشة.
I'm going to make dua for you, inshallah.
That Allah gave me guidance and guidance. I need guidance, wallahi. Guidance and.
Imam Karim is the dua and say the Rabbana afirni wa li walidayya wa lil mu'minina yawmakum wa sakinah.
Beautiful.
Enough?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. جزاك الله خير سيستر عائشة.
السلام
عليكم.
السلام عليكم.
وبركاته. ما شاء الله. I'm sorry, sister Aisha just turned on something that, you know, who is this? Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam.
Can you hold on for a second, please? We as imams, we go through a lot of this in our communities. And that's why, you know, sister Aisha opened up, you know, like a little wound. And, you know, we're entrusted with the religion. And we come into communities and we find them honoring these practices. And here is one of the most fascinating things that really, really get to you when they use the previous imams before you as a test, as a hujjah, as a testimony. يعني some of the brothers they would tell, listen, the imams before you never did this. They actually came and took part of this. Well, I tell them, يعني علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه says, اعرف الحق تعرف أهله. Learn the truth. You will know who's in the truth. الحق لا يعرف بالرجال ولكن الرجال يعرفون بالحق. You see, the truth is not to be known through the people. No, the people is to be known through the truth. وهذا قول ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه. من كان مقتديا فليقتدي بمن مات فإن الحي لا تؤمن عليه الفتنة. If you want to follow the footsteps of somebody, follow the footsteps of somebody who's dead. You see, here I'm sitting in front of you today. Allah knows best what he's going to do with me tomorrow. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يا إخوة, every day, oh Allah, you rotate the hearts. Grant our hearts steadfastness. Make dua for me that I stay on the path. But any living human being, he could lose it tomorrow. He could end up with the wrong thing, inshallah. جزاك الله خير, sister Aisha, and maybe we'll talk a little bit more about this. But the issue here is the brothers and the sisters, they follow the hearsay. And they follow the sunnah of the parents. And that is the problem. You see, somebody who was brought up in this culture for 40, 50 years, and nobody there stood for him and told him, listen, this is wrong. This is not right. This is a bid'ah. This is not a sunnah. So for him to come, some guy coming out of the blues and telling him, said, man, I saw my father doing this. At one time, I saw a brother who's praying and you know, he claiming that he's following the school of thought of Imam Malik and he's not placing his right hand on his left hand. Hadith sunnah. Look at the hadith. I mean, Imam Malik did it one time or two times ala sah al-aqwal because he could not do it. Now he's standing and doing like this. So I, you know, as the Imam, I told him, listen, you know, the sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Nahnu ma'ashir al-anbiya, umirna an nadha'a aymanana ala shama'ilina fi salah." We were commanded to place our right hands and our left hands in the salah. You know what he told me? Do you know more than one my tribe? All my tribe is doing this. So you tell me, are you better than my tribe? You need to understand this so that هذه يسمونها بسنة الآباء. This is the sunnah of the ancestors. And this is the first argument that nations used in discrediting the messengers and the prophets. Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ فِي قَرْيَةٍ مِنْ نَذِيرٍ إِلَّا قَالَ مُتْرَفُوهَا إِنَّا وَجَدْنَا آبَاءَنَا عَلَى أُمَّةٍ وَإِنَّا عَلَى آثَرٍ مُقْتَدُونَ. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, listen, we have not sent a messenger before you. But the first argument that he was faced with, the people would tell him, we found our fathers doing this and we're going to stick to it. Okay? Ibrahim, what did they say to Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam? أجئتنا بالحق كذلك وجدنا أباءنا يفعلون. This is how we found our father. We need to follow the text, follow the Quran and the Sunnah, and this is the way out of it.